Thank you. Okay, good evening. Today we are going to finish what we started yesterday, namely to discuss the Kerr black hole. But before we do this, let me mention a few things for next week. So if you go on the web page associated to these lectures, so in slides here in the map. So I propose that we have a next lecture on next week to discuss the dynamics of black holes, and possibly, but well, we have to check. It could be next Monday at 4 p.m. But okay, we will confirm. So I put a question mark here, and also possibly, if people are interested, I will make a pure SageMath session, just an introduction to SageMath. Not directly connected to black hole or anything. Then the day after, next Tuesday, it could be slightly after lunch, for instance, or well, we will find a slot. So please check this page for an update or the general website. We'll put things. Okay. So today we are going to focus on the Kerr black hole. So stationary black hole, and then next week we will discuss the dynamics, particularly the so-called thermodynamics of black holes, and also maybe the connection between black holes and gravitational waves. So what we did yesterday, let me remind you that we first introduced the Kerr solution found by Kerr in 63. Then we discuss the basic property from this metric, the basic property. Let me remind you that we notice there are three domains because here appears a quantity delta, which vanishes at two locations, r equal r plus and r equal r minus. So this defines two hypersurfaces, and we will see this is null hypersurfaces. This is two hypersurfaces, r plus and r minus. So in this O'Neill view with this exponential of r, so we have r minus infinity to the center. We have these two hypersurfaces here, and so we have region 1, region 2, and region 3. And also there is a singularity here, a ring singularity. When rho square is 0, we see this as a divergence in the metric coefficient, but it's a real curvature singularity. Whereas the singularity here, as we're going to see, is a pure, a mere coordinate singularity. Okay, so this was a few properties that we discussed. First of course, important, it's a solution of vacuum and Schlenk equation. Then, far from the central object, let's say, it reduces to the Schwarzschild metric. The metric, this line element reduces to Schwarzschild 1 in Schwarzschild Ross coordinate. Then we notice we have two symmetries in the spacetime, one which one may call pseudo-stationary because it is, strictly speaking, stationary only far from the system, because we have this vector is time-like far from for sufficiently large r. Then, okay, it was only stationarity, not staticity, because the Killing vector is not orthogonal to the hypersurfaces t equal constant. And the second symmetry of the Kerr spacetime is the axisymmetry. It's axisymmetric. And finally, when we notice when the parameter are two parameters in that solution A and M, when A is 0, we recover exactly a Schwarzschild metric. Okay, so we stopped here yesterday, so let's continue now. And by discussing a new feature that we have not seen for the Schwarzschild metric, this new feature is the concept of ergo region. What is it? It's simply we may, as I just mentioned, this Killing vector, this generator of translation symmetry, is time-like far from the system. And we may wonder where does it cease to be time-like? Why is it space-like, for instance? So it's very easy to see this. We take the scalar square of psi with the symmetric G, because psi, I should write it here maybe, is nothing in the Boyer-Lindquist coordinate. It's nothing but the coordinate vector associated to the t coordinate. So then the scalar square is nothing but the metric coefficient GTT. So GTT, we can read it on the metric element. It is this, that quantity. So when is it when xi is time-like, it means that has to be negative, this number. And you see that, well, one can detail things, but here's the result. It's negative, this number, only when r is smaller than a certain quantity or larger than another one. Between, it will be positive, so it means that xi will be time space-like. And this quantity depends on theta, because you have theta here. It's quite obvious that there are two things, because this problem, finding the sign of this, reduces to finding the sign of a second-order polynomial, okay, in R. So this is the two roots of the polynomial. So these roots depend on theta. And actually, with respect to the previous quantity which have been introduced, which do not depend on theta, this R minus and this R plus, maybe I should recall the expression of this. Yes, R plus is given by that formula, R minus by that formula. So with respect, maybe I will write them on the blackboard. R plus is m plus square root of m square minus a square. Actually, I can already take it's R plus minus this quantity. So this R e minus theta is below R minus, but it is positive. And the other one is above R plus, and it is always smaller than 2m. And by definition, we will call ergoregion the part of spacetime, I call it G, where xi is space-like. And the ergosphere, also by definition, will be the boundary of this region. So ergosphere is the boundary of the ergoregion. And so this ergoregion, we may notice, actually, it is the region here between these two things. And it encompasses a part of M2. I will maybe discuss more on this diagram. This is a meridional plot, again, of a curve spacetime. Again, we're using the O'Neill coordinates, so this exponential of r. And here, this is sine theta, and here, cos theta. So the axis of rotation, where the Killing vector d by d phi is zero, is exactly here. So this is a t equal constant slice, and a phi equal constant also slice, or phi is zero on that side, and pi on that side, more precisely. Okay, so here again, we have the r plus hypersurface, so this h, this is the r minus, and in gray, this is the ergo region. So you see it's a function of theta, this r e of theta here, and this is this r minus of theta here. Okay, what else do we see on this meridional cut? We see here the trace of the singularity ring. This is these two red dots. And in yellow, this is a funny region. Well, funny, but it's very far away from our universe, let's say. This is on region 3. This is called Carter time machine, because in that region, you have closed time-like curve. So it means you have time machine. But I will not discuss this. We could discuss this for many aspects. But in this lecture, I will focus more on the exterior of a black hole. We will not discuss too much the deep interior. But already, you start to see it could be quite complicated. Okay. So this is the view of this ergo region. So it, notice that it extends outside this. What we will show is the event horizon H. Yes. Because these two horizons, this is these two hypersurfaces that we noticed, this quantity delta vanish at two points because it's a polynomial in R. And these two points, yes, this is the two roots of this delta. So this is R plus and R minus. Okay. So the first horizon, this is R plus, R constant R plus. And the second one is R minus. And R minus is smaller than R plus. Still positive. So this is exactly that you have on. We could see also already here, already in this 3D view, we had the two horizons. And what I'm showing now is simply a meridional cut of this with the ergosphere. Here, there was no. The ergo region was not shown on that graph. I show it here. So it's simply a cut. Okay. So we recover the two. The two horizons. This in means inner horizon, and sometimes I will not have time to discuss this also today. This is called a Cauchy horizon in the lecture notes. which are available on the web page, you can see why it is called the Cauchy horizon, and this is explained. But I will not do it today. Okay. So since we have these two singularities in the Boyle-Lindquist coordinates, so we have singularities at rho equals zero and delta equals zero, we may try to remove at least some of them by a change of coordinates, exactly as we did for Schwarzschild, when we move from the Schwarzschild-Ross coordinates to the Eddington-Finkelstein ones. And we have actually this change of coordinates is a kind of generalization of the one we did for Schwarzschild. And this leads us to the Kerr coordinates. They are defined like this. So now, not only you remember for the Eddington-Finkelstein, we changed only the t coordinates into t tilde. We kept r, theta, and phi. Here, the novelty is that not only we change t, but we change also phi, the azimuthal coordinate. By this formula, if we integrate them, we get this formula. Okay. So if we make the change of coordinates, we may notice first when a goes to zero, it means the Schwarzschild case. Then in this formula, if you they reduce to this, for instance, is a zero, we have that phi tilde up to some constant is nothing but phi, and t tilde becomes this, and we recognize what we did for Schwarzschild, namely we recognize the going Eddington-Finkelstein one. So you may see this Kerr coordinates as a generalization to Eddington-Finkelstein. And let me remind you what I said in the introduction yesterday, that these Kerr coordinates, they are called Kerr coordinates, especially because Kerr used them to discover his solution. This was the original form of the solution. And so the original form is like this. It's slightly more complicated than in Boyle-Lindquist coordinates because you have more extra diagonal terms. In Boyle-Lindquist coordinates, you remember we had only the t phi term outside the diagonal. Here we have a t, well, t tilde, because it's a new time coordinate, r, and we have also a r phi term. Okay. But apart from this, it's not too much complicated with respect to Boyle-Lindquist, especially delta has disappeared. This annoying 1 over delta that we had in the Boyle-Lindquist, it has disappeared. You don't have any division by delta, even you don't see even delta. You have only division by rho square. So in the Kerr coordinate, you have only a singularity in the coordinates at rho equals zero. And, oops, sorry. And okay, so this is a nice feature of these coordinates. This means that this singularity that we had at r equal r plus and r equal r minus were mere coordinate singularity. And another remark that we should make, it's the same thing as we had already for Eddington-Finkelstein, is that the Killing vector can be written also as the coordinate vector of this new tilde coordinate. Okay. And similarly, the second Killing vector, eta, d by d phi, is also d by d phi tilde. Okay. Simply because nothing depends on tilde, t tilde on this metric element, and nothing depends on phi tilde. Okay, so let's have a look further on these two hypersurfaces, H and H in. By definition, they are constant R hypersurface because H, this is where R is R plus, which is a constant, and H inner is where R is R minus. So we may first investigate all the R equal constant hypersurface. And first thing to do is to notice that a normal to these hypersurfaces, by definition, is given by the gradient of R. Okay, so the gradient of R is given by this formula. This is a vector field. And it's given by the partial derivative of R with respect to the coordinate, but we raise the index with the metric tensor. And because this guy is a Kronecker delta mu R, it means it's 1 if the coordinate is R, otherwise it is 0, okay? So this means we have simply the metric coefficient, coefficient alpha R of the inverse metric. I haven't written the inverse metric, again it's written in the explicitly in the lecture notes, But it's pretty simple, actually. It is this guy. So this is for alpha equals 0, alpha equal 1, 2, and 3. It is this guy. And instead of taking exactly the gradient of r, I'm taking rho square, because to get rid of this rho square in the denominator. So then I have 2mr as the first component of this vector. I have delta as the second component. I have no component along theta because of a zero here. And then I have a as a component along phi. So this is my normal to the all, in the spacetime, all the r equal constant hypersurfaces, okay? Simply it's proportional to the gradient. And then I want to have a gender of this normal. Is it null, space-like, or time-like? So to do this, I take simply the scalar product of n with itself. So I have this. I simply replace here. I let appear again. I replace nu by this quantity to simplify slightly things, because this then will become this. And this, as you know, since you may consider R as a scalar field, is simply a partial derivative. And so you get this. And again, this partial derivative is a Kronecker delta. So it means nu has to be R. And so it's only the nR component, which is that one. So, which is that one more precisely. And so it means that at the end, I have rho square times that component, which is delta. So it's very simple expression. The scalar square of my null normal is delta. So I may say that since r plus and r minus, by definition, they are the two roots of delta. And if we look at the sign of this polynomial, we may conclude that the hypersurface r equal constant are time-like in the two regions 1 and 3. They are space-like in M2 between the two roots, actually. And on the roots, it means on H and on H inner, well, delta is 0. It means n is null vector. So since it's a normal, it means the hypersurfaces to which it is normal are null hypersurfaces, okay, by definition. So now we are convinced that these two these two horizons, are null hypersurfaces. Okay. This is the first point. Actually, they are much more than simply null hypersurfaces. They turn out to be killing horizon, which is very important. Why is it so? Well, again, on them, we may express, so I'm taking again this formula for the null normal, okay? And I express that r is either plus or minus. Delta is zero on them. And then this is eta. This I simply replace. I'm using this and this. Okay. So I get this formula. So I notice that my normal is actually a linear combination of the two killing vectors in spacetime. And moreover, this linear combination, I take chi, I rescale it by a constant here, a factor. So I get this, my new normal. My privilege normal now will be this one. It's privileged because it has one as a coefficient in terms in front of psi by construction. And this omega h, which appears here, it is that constant, a divided by 2mr plus. And since this is a constant, maybe you know that when you have two killing vectors, a linear combination of them with constant coefficient is again a killing vector. Okay, it means it's a symmetry generator. Of spacetime, except that this one is the kind, if you draw it in a spacetime diagram, it's a kind of helical killing vector because it has a component along phi and a component along t, like this. So this may be viewed then as a kind of rotation velocity. This is what I just said. And so, since I have a normal to my null hypersurface, which is a killing vector, this is nothing but the definition of a killing horizon that we gave in the previous lecture. So my null hypersurface is a killing horizon, and similarly, the H inner is also a killing horizon. And we may picture it like this, this H. As I said, the field line, so this L here actually is proportional to chi. So the killing vector chi is like this, and so it has a component of psi also along phi like this. So it is like this, and its field line are the null generators of the null hypersurface H. This is the green lines here on this. And of course, the null cones have to be along because they are tangent to this null hypersurface like this. Okay. And the Xi is the hypothetically time-like killing vector. And notice here it is space-like because on this drawing it is outside the null cones. And this is not surprising because if we go back to our picture of the ergo region, like this, on H except at the pole, we are inside the ergo region. So H is inside the region where Xi is space-like, okay, by definition of the ergo region. So it's not surprising to see that on the horizon, Xi is space-like. And if you contrast this plot with the plot that we've seen before of the non-expanding horizon or the Maplini plots that I did about the Schwarzschild horizons, you may wonder why are the null generator not vertical in this plot, where this seems to roll like this. Well, it's a matter of representations. This is an equivalent picture of things where this time the null generators are vertical straight line as we draw them before. And these two things are completely topologically equivalent. I will not spend too much time on it, but this is some points to make some identification. This is the same point A here, here. And here, the null cones are vertical. They are tangent to the horizon because this is a null hypersurface. And now Xi is rolling along this null generator. So when we draw, this is simply a mere coordinate liberty of space that we have in general relativity. When we draw a space-time diagram like this, here we may say the space-time diagram is rooted on the null generator because they give a privileged direction, namely the vertical one. But on the same surface, we could have taken the field lines of Xi, which are space-like field lines, as a privileged direction. Okay, it's the same object, same thing. Okay, and not only this H is a killing horizon, but it turns out to be a real event horizon. To do this, we can draw again, as we did for Schwarzschild, we can draw the radial of null geodesics. But for Kerr, we have various families. This one is the so-called principal null families. I will not enter too much into details here. Again, all the details are in the lecture notes. But we may say, again, we have two families. One is ingoing, and the other one is outgoing. And we see that at any point outside H, we may reach infinity. I mean, if you follow this far enough, well, you have to be convinced, but it becomes vertical only on H. So this means all this region can be seen from Sky plus. When I'm speaking about Sky plus, because we already noticed that asymptotically, the Kerr metric is like the Schwarzschild metric, so it has the same asymptotics actually. So it has the same kind of scrapers that we've examined already for Schwarzschild. So if we give if we went back to the rigorous definition of a black hole, which takes into account, which define it as the complement of the causal past of scrapers, we can do exactly the same job here, and we will find that this is H is actually the black hole horizon, and all this part is inside the black hole. So the Kerr solution does represent a black hole, and moreover, we will see it's a rotating black hole. But before we see the rotating aspect, well, it's connected, but let me discuss a very important physical process, the Penrose process. We may say up to now, discussing the Kerr solution, we presented more the geometry of the solution. Now we will focus more on the physics in this part. So what is it? Here I have a view from above, let's say. So the rotation axis will be perpendicular to the plane of the blackboard, well, of the screen. The black part is the black hole part. And the gray part is the ergo region part. So this is the ergosphere. We may imagine that this is cut in the equatorial plane of a black hole. And in this cut, we suppress there is no time dimension. This is simply well, a representation of the equatorial plane of a black hole. And I consider a particle P, which comes from infinity, which is falling into the ergo region. And at some point in the ergo region, it splits in two parts, in two particles. One is falling inside the black hole, and the other one is escaping to infinity. It's possible from the ergo region to escape to infinity because by the definition of this region, you are not inside the black hole. So if you choose carefully your trajectory, it's possible that there is no reason for you to not stay to stay into the ergo region. So you can escape to infinity. And I denote by P the four momentum of this particle. Here, of course, I represent P like this, like if it was a space vector, but you have to remember for any particle, P is either a null vector, if the particle is a photon, or a time-like vector, if the particle is a massive particle. Okay. So here, what you have in the diagram is more a kind of projection of P onto the plane of a drawing here. You have to keep in mind that it has a time part. Okay. And I denote P prime, of course, the momentum of the four momentum of the escape Kim particle, and P second, the four momentum of a particle which is going inside the black hole. And I may define naturally the energy gain of in this process like this. This is the energy that I have in the output of this particle minus the energy of the entering particle. I define this the energy gain because if this delta E turns out to be positive, then I'm getting an outgoing particle which has more energy than the ingoing particle. Okay. And now, this energy, if I measure them far from the black hole at infinity, they are given by this scalar product here. Why is it so? Maybe here I recall the geometrical interpretation of the four momentum of a particle. If you have in space-time, I should not move too much, maybe, like this, okay. If you have, it can be in special relativity, in general relativity, whatever. If you have an observer, which has a certain world line, it has to be time-like, so it's inside the net cone. It's fully characterized by its four velocity, which is the unit time-like vector tangent to its world line, you know. And then you have a particle which crosses the world line of the observer at that point. This is the point where the observer will really make the observation of the particle, they make some measurement, let's say. So this order, and this particle is fully characterized by its four momentum vector P. As I said, it is tangent to the world line of the particle. And so here the world line can be either time-like, like it is drawn here inside the null cone, or it can be also tangent to the null cone, meaning a null world line, meaning the particle is a photon. Then the energy measured by the observer, the energy of a particle, is given by this very simple formula. It's simply the scalar product of a four velocity of the observer with P, with the four momentum. The four momentum, it's a four vector, it's completely intrinsic to the particle. It does not depend on any observer. Whereas the energy of a particle does depend on the observer. The energy is not an absolute in relativity quantity. It's always it's like velocity. It's always relative to an observer. But for velocity, for momentum, they are absolute quantities. They do not depend on any observer, the characteristic of a particle. So it's given by this formula. You may rewrite it in the momentum four form like this, but okay. Let's skip about this. So it's given by, accessorily, we may also notice that the free momentum, or linear momentum measured by the observer, is given by this formula. And actually, it's the orthogonal projection in the plane, hyperplane orthogonal to the four velocity of the observer, which is a kind of rest frame, rest plane of this observer. So you have this orthogonal decomposition. So given this absolute quantity, and this absolute quantity as well, the orthogonal decomposition gives the relative quantity, the energy measured, and the linear momentum measured by the observer. So let's focus on that quantity here. So if I want to get the energy of my particle at infinity, I will use this quantity, and here this will be the four velocity of my inertial observer at infinity. And it turns out that such an inertial observer is provided by the Killing vector xi, because xi at infinity, because xi is d by dt, and at infinity, d by dt is a scalar square minus 1. It's a unit time-like vector when I am far from the black hole. It's not true close to the black hole, but far from the black hole, the scalar square of Xi or d by dt is minus 1. This is nothing to say that gtt, the metric coefficient gtt, goes to minus 1 when I'm far from the black hole. Okay, so it's a very valid for velocity because it is unit. Okay, so this is a physically measured quantity energy. So this is the energy in and this is the energy out. So I may replace here in this expression. Okay. Then let me remind you also a second important thing. This is what we may call the geodesic notaire theorem. It's the following thing. As soon as you have a space-time which has a Killing vector, so a symmetry, one parameter group of isometry generated by a Killing vector Xi, as we have here. And when we have a geodesic, and I forgot maybe to write it, but all these trajectories, I assume they are geodesics. It means these particles, they feel nothing but the gravitational field. Okay? They don't have, for instance, don't imagine this is a spaceship with its own rocket. No, it has to follow a geodesic. Otherwise, what I'm saying is not valid. So I'm assuming everything is following a geodesic. And when I am on a geodesic, whose tangent vector field is P, for instance, it can be the four momentum of a particle, and it obeys the geodesic equation, like this. Then it turns out that the scalar product of Xi, the Killing vector with P, is constant along the geodesic. Okay? This is an easy theorem. I give a proof here. I will not detail it. Well, it's very easy, but so it requires, of course, the Killing equation and also the fact that I am on a geodesics. These two zero, so this derivative vanish, meaning that this quantity is constant because I have two zero. First, I have a Killing vector. Second, I have a geodesic. Okay. Why is this theorem useful here? It's very useful because my energy, as I said, is given by the scalar product, and the scalar product, they are nothing but the quantity which is conserved by the Noether theorem. Well, it's not the theorem due to Noether, it's a kind of particular case of what Noether did. So I may consider that the scalar product that I took at infinity, actually, it keeps its value all the way up to A. So I can replace this quantity here, but the same scalar product, but taken at point A. Similarly, for particle P prime, I was interested in the output energy far from the black hole, but this quantity, the scalar product, is the same, take the same value, it's the same value as at the point A. Let me stress something that at this point A, this is not a physically measured energy. It has the same value as the energy at infinity, but because Xi is no longer a time-like vector here. So it's not a for velocity, so this has no physical interpretation at A, okay? But it has the same value. And then, here I notice that I have the same vector Xi here, and since G is a bilinear form, I can write like this, by bilinearity, okay? This addition, I put it, or this difference, if you want, I put it into, maybe there is a sign error here, yes, probably. Apparently it should have been a prime here, and, okay? But okay. So this is Xi here. So now I am going to use another important physical law, is the conservation of energy momentum. And it's very, well, I think you are convinced that at the point here, where the particle split in two particles, I have to have a p at a is p prime plus p second, okay? As a vector in space time. So this means that this quantity here is p second here, okay? And then I have this. I'm still puzzled by my sign here. Probably this was not correct. Oops, yes. Yes, this is P he out. So I should have started by this guy. So yes, the very first one, I should have inverted these signs. Okay, this is should minus P out. Okay, so at the end, this is correct. This is the important thing. I will correct in the slides, but this expression at the end is correct. And now, so this is my energy gain expressed in terms only of the scalar product of P second with Killing vector Xi. And now I'm using the fact that this event takes place in the ergo region. This is very important. Why? Because if it was outside the ergo region, here outside the ergo region, Xi is a time-like vector. necessarily by definition of your Gaussian. And p second, it's a four momentum vector, so by definition it is always a future directed time like or null vector. It's null if a particle is a photon, but otherwise, but it is also always future directed. And it's an easy theorem, an easy lemma if you want, to show that the scalar product with a metric tensor of two future directed time like or null vector is necessarily negative. It cannot be, because psi is time like, the scalar product has to be negative if psi is time like. But here we are inside the Argo region, and now psi is space like, so you cannot apply this theorem. And actually, the scalar product can take any sign. It depends on the precise configuration, on the trajectories here. So I could very well choose a trajectory to ensure that the scalar product is positive, because psi is space-like. And if I do this, then I get that the delta E is positive. So I have a net gain of energy. The particle which comes out here, P prime, has more energy than the internal particle. This is the so-called Penrose process. This is very generic process. I explain it in elementary ways in terms of a single particle, but it can be applied also to a field. In case of field, it's generally called super radiance, this process. And also, we believe very strongly that it is active in astrophysical settings. Oops, it is an example of a Penrose process, most probably at work, I should have said, but I don't think we can explain such a physical phenomena otherwise. This is a picture taken by the Hubble Space Telescope of the central part of the giant elliptic galaxy M Messier 87, which is at the center of the Virgo cluster, which is the biggest cluster of galaxies close to our galaxy. And we see a few things, a very bright nucleus. And the brightness is this nucleus. We explain it today by saying here we have a very massive black hole. We have a black hole which is 3 billion solar masses. And around this black hole, we have a big accretion disk. Some gas is swirling into the black hole. And due to the differential rotation in this accretion disk, we have friction, and so we have heating, and we have a very luminous object. And by this process, a large part of the energy of the mass which is in this accretion disk is released in radiation. So this process is a very efficient process to release the energy, the mass energy of a particle. So you have this famous Einstein formula. And if you want to take energy out of the mass energy, as you know, you have some, you may think about the nuclear reaction, thing like this, but as you know, the most energetic nuclear reaction, which is the fusion of hydrogen, takes out only 1% of, at most, 1% of the total MC squared as radiation. Whereas with this process of accretion around the black hole, I don't have time to detail it here, you can release up to 42% of the total MC square. So it's very efficient process, and we believe this is this process which happening here. But this is not the Penrose process. This is simply the accretion, the friction in the accretion disk. The Penrose process, probably we see it here. We have a very powerful jet which is emitted from the central region. The black hole, you cannot see it, but because at that scale, it's like a tiny dot. And this jet, it's very large. It has almost the same size as the galaxy itself. Here you have 1.5 kiloparsec. So it's very huge jet. And moreover, the velocity of this jet is really enormous. I mean, it's almost the velocity of light. So here we have, I don't know how many solar masses that we have, but it's a huge energy in this jet because we have this velocity of light. And to our knowledge, this emission is due to actually in fine to the Penrose process. So this energy is taken on the rotation energy of a black hole. Of course, this process will not involve particles which split into, but it probably it will involve as an intermediate the magnetic field around the black hole, and quite complicated magneto-hydrodynamic process. But the basic of it is the Penrose process. Yes? Yes, blunt and snide, yeah. Yeah, yes, it's there are many models. It's quite very complicated physics because this is magnetohydrodynamics in this curve background, and well, but it's not fully understood at the end. But most astrophysicists are convinced that this is the Penrose process in fine. So the energy is taken from the rotational energy of a black hole. Yes. Oh, so the emission is due to syn mostly synchrotron emission from electrons, so but the party in terms of particles, it's mostly proton. It's a plasma, so it's mostly proton and electron, and the emission is due to mostly to the electron. But there is a lot of mass due to the proton. Yeah, sorry. The magnetic field is really important here in the very close at the base of a jet. After this, it's very collimated because it's moving very fast, and then it's interacting with the interstellar medium. Probably this is a sign of interaction here, and it's very complicated physics all this. I'm just I don't want to enter too much in detail, but just to show it that this Penrose process is not simply something pure theoretical or like this. Okay, and to move on for on the Kerr black hole, now I will discuss, because this will be very important for the next lecture about the dynamics of a black hole. I will discuss the global quantities. A first physical quantity that we may think of is the mass, because okay, we notice that we had two parameters in the Kerr solution. The small one was small m, so we may think maybe it's a mass. Okay, and yes, indeed it is a mass. How can we see this? Well, in general relativity, we have a very general definition of mass as soon as we have a time-like Killing vector, or asymptotically time-like Killing vector, so a stationary space-time. Then the mass is defined by this integral, which is expressed in terms of a Killing vector psi, so you have a covariant derivative of psi here. And here, this is the volume phi form associated to the metric. It's also known as Levi-Civita tensor. This is the space-time volume element. So it's a fully anti-symmetric tensor. So if you make this contraction on the first two indices, there are two free indices, alpha, beta. So it means you have a two form, an anti-symmetric form, and you make the integral on two surface. And as you know, if you look back to your books about the theory of integration, the integration is well defined when you have a n form, a p form on a p-dimensional surface. So here we have a two form which is integrated on a two surface. And this, the nice thing here is that this integral is completely independent of a choice of a space-like two surface. It can be any two sphere in space-time as soon as this sphere is located in vacuum. Here we are, it's okay, in vacuum region. It cannot be a sphere. For instance, you have a star, you cannot take the sphere to be inside the star. It has to be outside the star. But here we are in vacuum, we are in the Kerr, so it can be taken anywhere. And this integral, because this is a Killing tensor vector, will give always the same value. So this is a kind of very mathematical definition of a mass, okay, because it let appear this volume phi form and this covariant derivative of Killing tensor. But it has a nice physical interpretation, and the physical interpretation is really a measurable quantity. It's the mass that you feel if you are outside the object, and in particular if you are orbiting the object. If you are orbiting far enough, then the Newton's law of gravitation becomes valid, more and more valid, the more valid, the more far you are from the central object. And then you may apply, for instance, Kepler third law. So you measure your period of rotation by your own local clock, and then you can, by Kepler third law, relate it to the central mass. And this is nothing but this quantity, which is given by the so-called Comar integral, like this. So this is physical interpretation, so it's really the gravitational mass in some sense of the object. So we may apply this to the Kerr black hole. You have no time to do it here. Again, it's in the lecture notes. I give you immediately the result. No big surprise. The result is the mass parameter m. Okay? Yes, question? No, I leave it free because again this is a two form here. I could have written maybe in more index free notation. This is a so-called Hodge dual of this two form here. But so it means I have a two form and I don't have to contract to normal vector or thing like this or surface element. This is maybe what you have in hand because a two form it has an intrinsic integral on any two surface. Right, okay. Maybe there are also more details on this in the lecture notes. Not maybe, but certainly. Okay. So this is for the mass. Another natural question, especially because we investigated also, well, I spoke a lot about rotation, is the concept of angular momentum. So again, it's given by a similar integral. It's called Komar integral, except that the minus 1 over 8 pi is replaced by plus 1 over 16 pi. And the stationary Killing vector is replaced by the Killing vector, axisymmetric Killing vector. So the angular momentum in general relativity is well defined as soon as you have axisymmetric Killing vector. Otherwise, very ill-defined, by the way, contrary to the linear momentum. But okay. And simply, you have exactly the same formula. And again, this is a mathematical definition, if you want. It does not depend on the choice of the two surfaces here. But it has a nice physical interpretation. The interpretation is that it is related to what Thomas shown this morning, the so-called magnetic part of the gravitational field, or so-called lens steering part. It's that, for instance, if you take a gyroscope, so again, you are orbiting about your central object, and in your rocket, you have a gyroscope, and you know that in Newtonian physics, the gyroscope should keep a constant direction. In GR, the gyroscope will precess, and it will precess because of two effects. One is the so-called geodetic effect. This effect will be here even if the central object is non-rotating. Actually, this is the dominant effect. And you have a smaller effect, which is due to the spin of a central object, to this J here. And if you measure this you will get a direct measure of the total angular momentum of your object. By the way, this has been measured by gravity probe B experiment a few years ago due to the spinning of the Earth. So it was a satellite which has been put around the Earth with a gyroscope. The main effect, the geodetic precession, has been measured with a very great accuracy. And because of some technical problem of the experiment, unfortunately, we were not capable to measure the lens steering effect to a very good accuracy. I think they get the result with 10 to 20%, something like this error bar. So, but it's still, we may say it has been. So this is this effect J here. So again, for the Kerr black hole, we know everything. We know eta, we know we can take the covariant derivative, can make this computation. This is done in detail in the lecture note, and we get this result, very simple result, is the product of A to by M. So we may say that this parameter A that we had in the Kerr solution is nothing but the specific angular momentum. Namely, it's the angular momentum divided by the mass. When I say angular momentum, I should have maybe be more clear. Angular momentum, generally, it's a free vector. Here, I have only a number. So this is the z component of the angular momentum. I have rotation. The other component would be zero. Okay. Okay, another interesting global quantity characterizing the black hole is its area. Remember, we noticed in the previous lecture that any non-expanding horizon is an area which does not depend on the choice of a cross-section. This was a nice feature of this non-expanding horizon. And since here H is a Killing horizon, it's a peculiar case of non-expanding horizon. And so we may speak about its area. It does not depend, again, on the choice of S. So to evaluate it for the Kerr black hole, we will choose a nice S, nice for a computation, a very simple one, because the result at the end, we know that it should not depend on such a choice. So first of all, we are going to compute it in the Kerr coordinates, not in the Boyle-Lindquist one. Why? Because let me remind you, the Boyle-Lindquist coordinates are singular on the horizon. So you can make no computation with them because they are singular. Some quantity will diverge. Maybe they will be compensated by other quantity, but you may make there may be some mistake, non-compensation. So you are not sure of what you are doing on this with this singular coordinate. So we move to the Kerr coordinates, and then we choose a slice of the horizon, a constant curve time slice, and of course r also will be constant because on the horizon r is 2r plus. So we have only two varying coordinates, theta and phi. This remains simply that this cross section have the topology of a two sphere. And then the area is given by this formula. This is the square root, this is the volume element induced by the space-time metric. So Q is the metric induced by the space-time metric on S. So we have to compute Q, and more precisely square root of the determinant of Q to compute the area. This is very easy because, again, we go to back to the expression of a Kerr metric in Kerr coordinates. It is like this, with this off-diagonal term that we have just seen. But here, when the situation with t tilde is constant, so we will have d t tilde is zero. R is also constant because we had a fixed location in R, so we have dr equals zero. And moreover, we will replace R everywhere by R plus. So if I'm looking for the induced metric, so the induced line element, so this is zero, this is zero, this is zero, all the dt are zero, dr is zero, and this one which has a dr is zero. So there remains only the last line, okay? Let me remind you that rho square in the Kerr metric rho was a shorthand notation for r square plus a square cosine theta square. So my rho square I can replace by this. R is r plus, okay? So I get this line element, and here I simply replace r by r plus. So I get this for the metric induced on my cross section on my horizon. And I can simplify further because I notice that r plus is a zero of delta. Delta was the second order polynomial. So I may write that 2m r plus is equal to this. So I may replace this 2m r plus, which appears here, by this expression. So I get this 2 metric here. And so now it's very easy to compute the determinant because it's diagonal form. So the determinant is simply the product of this term by that term, so this simplifies. So the determinant is very simple. It is simply this term and this term, okay? And what I need actually is the square root of the determinant. So this is positive quantity. I can take the square root nicely. So I get this at the end of the day, only this integral to evaluate. This is elementary integral, and the value of which on the sphere is 4 pi. So my area, it is 4 pi times this term. And I can again use this formula if I wish to replace it in terms of r plus. And if I remember this formula here, I can get rid of r plus and express the area in terms of my two fundamental parameters of a Kerr solution, which are m and a. Okay, this is the area, and you may check that when a is zero, you recover the Schwarzschild formula that we have seen already. Okay, so this is the black hole area. And a last global quantity, which is important and will play a crucial role in the discussion next week about the dynamics of a black hole, is the so-called surface gravity. So what is it? You can see this as a definition. It's nothing but a quantity that we have seen before in lecture one. This is the non-affinity coefficient of a null normal to the event horizon. Let me remind you one of the basic properties of a null hypersurfaces. They are ruled by null geodesics, and moreover, the null normal to the null hypersurface is tangent to this null geodesics. And so this means here we know the null normal. This is this vector chi with this helical line, and they rotating to that velocity with respect to xi and eta, the two killing vector. So it means this is a pre-geodesic vector. It's tangent to geodesic, to the null generator of the horizon. So it has to obey this equation. It's almost the geodesic equation on H only, but there is a non-affinity parameter. It means if chi was associated to an affine parameter of a null geodesics, this would be zero, but it's not zero in general. And again, this equation is valid only on H. If you compute this outside the horizon, it has no reason to be collinear to chi here. So how to compute this? Well, it is sufficient to compute this, but this is a covariant derivative in the Kerr spacetime of a certain vector field given by these components here. So it's quite sometimes complicated. There is a SageMath notebook who is doing the job for you, so you can check this notebook here. And you get the final result, again, in terms of the two fundamental Kerr parameters. And this is, at this point, we may make a remark that this quantity does not depend on theta. It's constant. It depends only on M on A. So for a given Kerr black hole, it's constant. And you may be surprised about this because here we are in axisymmetry. Many things were depending on theta, a priori. And here you are computing a local quantity on the horizon. So depending on which value of theta you take, this could have taken various various values. It was not obvious at all that it has to be constant. And this is a very important thing. Actually, it's related to the so-called Zeroff law of black hole thermodynamics. It's like saying that the temperature of a body in equilibrium, and here we're dealing with a black hole in equilibrium, is constant over all the body, the so-called Zeroff law. But we will discuss this next week in more detail. Okay. And just a final remark on this kappa, it's called surface gravity. You may say, oh, this is a very physical term, surface gravity. So maybe this is the gravity that I measure when I am at the surface of a black hole. But as Tom pointed out this morning, when you have a surface of a black hole, the gravity that you feel is infinite. Okay, you cannot stay quiet unless you have an infinite acceleration very close to a black hole. So this is in some sense quite a misleading name. There was a dispute actually about this name. This name was chosen by Stephen Hawking in the 70s, but people like Brandon Carter were very much against this name. They really favor this non-affinity name because they think it's not physical, it's not surface gravity. Well, actually, it's a kind of rescaled surface gravity. If you rescale it by kind of diverging redshift factor, then you get surface gravity. And moreover, you may have a kind of physical-like interpretation is that if you have a very long rope, and you are at infinity, quite in a safe region, very far from the black hole. And if you try to maintain an object very close to the black hole, so in practice, it's impossible because the rope will break near the black hole because it will be submitted to this infinite gravity. But assume that you have a very stiff, infinitely stiff rope, very solid one, then the force that you as a far observer will have to exert is finite, it's not infinite to maintain this object. This is a kind of time dilation effect. Don't remember that a force in dynamics, it's the derivative of a momentum, linear momentum with respect to time. Okay? And so because you have a kind of time dilation effect, you can have here far from what I call a finite force, whereas it's an infinite force on the other side. So in that sense, you can interpret it like surface gravity, but okay. It's maybe safer to say it's just a name which was given for historical reason. And okay. It's Stephen Hawking's fault. Okay. Finally, before we break to go to dinner, I have only two slides just to conclude about the Kerr black hole. And it could have been an introduction actually, because this motivates very much the study of Kerr black hole. Because after all, we may say, okay, it's a solution which was found in 1963 by a New Zealander mathematician. Why do you care about it so much? And okay, I care about it so much because actually this solution turns out to represent all the black holes in equilibrium in the universe. And this is the so-called Noether theorem. This is probably the most beautiful theoretical result obtained in general relativity, except from getting exact solution. Of course, it's a very nice result, the Kerr solution. But except from exact solution, the most beautiful result is this Noether theorem. And actually, it has not been shown just at once, like Kerr exhibited his solution in 1963 from himself. But this Noether theorem is due to the work of many people. It has been first shown in very peculiar case, for example, in case of spherical symmetry. And then gradually it was extended. So it started in 10 years from the Russian school first, around Zeldovich. It was the premise of this Noether theorem. Then the spherically symmetric case was achieved by Israel. And then Carter did the axisymmetry case. Hawking generalized it to the no symmetry except stationarity equilibrium, but don't assume axisymmetry. And then Robinson's make things more clear, more refine certain details. So the theorem is like this. You have to assume four dimensions, first of all. You have to be in four-dimensional space-time. Second, the gravitation has to obey general relativity, so it's in the framework of general relativity. Okay. Then another hypothesis is that the black hole has to be stationary. If it is a dynamical black hole, if it is a binary black hole merger, forget about this. Okay. So under these three basic assumptions, which seems quite natural, I mean, especially we are interested in black hole equilibrium. Any black hole in the universe, provided it is always empty, if you have masses close to a black hole, it will disturb it and the result will be no longer true. But if a black hole is really isolated and in equilibrium, it has to be the Kerr black hole, or more precisely, an electric charge generalization of a Kerr black hole, which is called Kerr-Newman black hole. It's a solution of the electro vacuum Einstein equation, which reduces to vacuum in case of no electric charge. And it described by only three parameters: the mass, the specific angular momentum A, as we have seen, and the total electric charge. I don't show you the full solution, the Kerr-Newman solution. It's almost like the Kerr solution, except that you have an extra term with a charge. Yes? No. This is the most general solution if you assume, if you authorize. Yes, but in astrophysics, it's almost impossible to have a globally charged object because if you have somewhere in the universe, a black hole, a Kerr-Newman black hole, let's say, with a positive charge, immediately you will have particles from the interstellar medium with the opposite charge, which will be pulled to this black hole, and very soon it will be neutralized by the particle from the interstellar medium because the electric field is the electric force is so large with respect, for instance, to the gravitational force, as you know, that it will attract well many particles. And so we don't believe we have globally charged black hole in the universe. This is why I didn't pay too much time to describe the Kerr-Newman black hole. But well, in full general relativity, the black hole is described by this free number, but it's adding a charge is simply adding another number. So we have only three number, and this theorem has been summarized by John Wheeler. You know, John Wheeler is the same guy who coined the term black hole. Actually, apparently, he did not invent it himself. He was giving a kind of public talk in the 1965. No, yes, 1965 in the United States. He was describing this completely collapsed object, as they called them at the time. And in the audience, somebody shouted, "Oh, but your object, it's a kind of black hole." And Wheeler said, "Wow, black hole, that sounds nice term, maybe." This resume, this summarize many, many facets of this object. And instead of telling to his colleague, "Oh, you know what, we should call this black hole," and then there will have been a big debate in the committee. No, he didn't do it like this. He started to use the word as it was a natural word. We have a black hole, and he put black hole in his papers and something. So gradually it spread like this, and it was accepted by everybody. So Wheeler has many wanted always to have nice name, and he summarized this theorem by saying a black hole has no hair. What does this mean exactly? Well, this means that it's very smooth object. It's a kind of bald, not bald, baldy surface, because it has only three numbers. You need only three numbers to describe it. If you think about it, if you compare with, for instance, a star or a planet, you need much more than just three numbers to describe the object. You have to have functional degree of freedoms to describe the mountains, the oceans, and whatever, and things like this. So, okay. So in this respect, with the planet, they start describing all the air on the surface of. Okay, so it has no air, only free airs, we could say. Okay. And as we just said, the most interesting part is the neutral, electric neutral part, and this is nothing but the Kerr solution that we have discussed today. And if you set A to be zero, you have only one air, then it is the mass, okay, M. It's the famous Schwarzschild solution. And if you keep the charge but still put no rotation, you have a quite old solution. It's kind of easy generalization, well, not so easy, generalization of Schwarzschild, which was found by Reissner and Nordström very soon. Okay. So this is the statement of a no air theorem. And just to finish, I want to put maybe a more rigorous statement because here we have a word theorem. So if there is any mathematician in the audience, we say, well, what is this? It does not look exactly like a theorem. So here is the theorem. This is a theorem for a mathematician, a real theorem. You take a space-time, so a Lorentzian manifold equipped with Lorentzian matrix, so differential manifold equipped with Lorentzian matrix, four-dimensional, asymptotically flat, defined in rigorous term, pseudo-stationary, it means there is a killing vector which is asymptotically time-like. You want the Ricci tensor of this guy to be zero, it means physically it's a solution of a vacuum Einstein equation. It contains a black hole in the general definition of a black hole with a scry and the causal past of the scry, and the complementary region of the causal past is the black hole region. This black hole has to have a connected regular horizon. Okay, another hypothesis. And another hypothesis, there are two remaining hypotheses which are important in that stuff. It has to have no time-like, closed time-like curve outside the black hole. That is what could be called, technically speaking, the domain of outer communications. And final hypothesis is that it is analytic. And, and then the conclusion is that the exterior of a black hole, do you hear me? Yes. The exterior of a black hole is a part of a curved space-time. So first of all, you may notice that the rigorous version of this theorem does not tell you that all the space-time is curved, only the exterior. It's already very strong. But and second thing that you may notice, this is two hypotheses that maybe you want to get rid of. Because physically speaking, it's quite annoying. To prove it, I am obliged to suppose that I have no closed time-like curve outside the black hole. So it could be that, after all, in the universe, I have a black hole which is not the curved black hole. And moreover, just outside it, I have closed time-like curve. I have time machines. This is not excluded by this theorem. It's highly improbable, we may say, as a physicist, but it's not excluded by the theorem. And another thing which is quite annoying for a physicist is the analyticity assumption. It's very strong because in physics, usually we don't deal with analytic field, we deal with smooth field. Infinitely differentiable, or maybe we can lack some differentiability if you have a shock wave. But we deal with smooth field. Analytic is very strong. It means you can expand everything in terms of power series. And usually, you know, analytic function, for example, if you know its value in a small region of space, then it fully determines everywhere else in the space-time. So it's kind of non-causal behavior, for instance. So we want to get rid of this hypothesis, and there have been some heavy work in mathematical physics about this. For instance, people have been capable to get rid of this annoying hypothesis of analyticity only recently, I mean 4 years ago, but only for slowly rotating black hole, not in the general case. And nobody yet has been capable to get rid of this quite physically annoying possibility. We don't want closed time like that. Okay, so this was the Noether theorem. So the idea that you have to keep in mind is that every black hole in the universe has to be a curved black hole, and in particular, coming back to gravitational waves, the final product of a merge of the two black holes that LIGO detected a few years ago is most probably, according to this theorem, it has to be a curved black hole. We didn't observe this product especially. We hope to observe a quasi-normal ringing of this curved black hole. But the really equilibrium state, by definition, it emits no gravitational waves, it emits nothing, it remains stationary. And according to this theorem, it has to be a curved black hole. Yes? Using what internal? Eternal. No, actually, it's more. It's more considering the exterior of a black hole. So you don't need, because this this distinction between this eternal. I will speak about this also in the next session. Between eternal black hole and the real ones, which are formed by the collapse of matter, it's important only for the inside of a black hole. Outside, it should be the same. And in this theorem, they regard actually only the outside of the black hole.
So we should expect it to hold
yes.
For a black hole that is created through collapse.
Yes, exactly. Yes. So it's very, in that sense, it's quite a powerful theorem. except for these two hypotheses. Okay, so I think it's time to break for dinner, and so see you next week or before probably.